welcome to Sunday worship here at Neilston Parish Church. I'm the Reverend Matthew Ritchie, and it is so great that you are able to join us today. We're going to be continuing our look through the book of Luke, and we're going to be looking at the announcement of a new child. Not that one, a different one. We are, of course, following government guidelines, closed to in-person worship at the moment. But that doesn't mean that there is not loads going on. Best place to find out about all of that is on our Facebook and on our website. The links to them are at the end. God graces us with his presence. Whether we are here in a specific building, whether we're in our own homes or in others' homes, whether we're listening in the car on the way to work, as long as we are making time for God, God is there. Welcome, one and all.
Come, now is the time to time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are.
We've worshipped God through music. Now let's lift our hearts and worship God in our prayers. Let's pray. Our Father, we come to you this morning in different places, having had very different weeks. For some of us, they've been an exciting week, full of new things and good news. For some of us, it's not been. But however we've had our week, however we come to you, whether it's bouncing and excited or whether we're kind of on our knees, we thank you for your presence. We thank you that we can simply lift our voices to you. Or if we can't do that, that we just lift our souls. That you will know and that you will understand and that you will always listen. We thank you for the things that you've done throughout our lives. Those miracles, small and large, that have got us to where we are. We thank you for the times that you were with us, sometimes when we didn't even realise. And we thank you for the times when you have been what's got us through. We know, our God, that as great and as powerful as you are, as mighty and as loving, that we are not always the same. We're not perfect. We do things that are wrong. We do things that hurt you, that hurt each other, that hurt our world. And for those we're sorry, we come to you asking for forgiveness. We know, our Lord, that because of your mercy and because of your love, when we approach you truly sorry, we are truly forgiven. Our God, as we take this time just now, just to dedicate time to you, taking time out of whatever we're doing today, that you would bless us with your presence. Bless us as we're here. Our God, the Bible is full of stories of when you have helped your people in the past, when you have brought them close to you. And we pray that you would do the same for us today. Bring us closer to your presence, to your spirit, and to your will. We pray all this in your Son's name, but we also use his words as we say together the family prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We're continuing our journey through the book of Luke, and we reach a really interesting narrative. It's Luke 1, verses 5 to 25. The birth of John the Baptist foretold. In the time of King Herod of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah, who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah. His wife, Elizabeth, was also a descendant of Aaron. Both of them were righteous in the sight of God, observing all of the Lord's commandments and decrees blamelessly. But they were childless, because Elizabeth was not able to conceive, and they were both very old. Once, when Zechariah's division was on duty, and he was serving as priest before God, he was chosen by lot, according to the custom of the priesthood, to go into the temple of the Lord and burn incense. And when the time for the burning of incense came, all the assembled worshippers were praying outside. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him, standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was gripped with fear. The angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear a son, and you are to call him John. He will be a joy and a delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or any other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he's born. He will bring back many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the parents of their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous and make ready a people prepared for the Lord. Zechariah asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I'm an old man and my wife is well along in years." The angel said to him, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I've been sent here to speak to you and tell you this good news. And now you will be silent and not able to speak until the day this happens, because you did not believe my words, which will come true at their appointed time." Meanwhile, the people were waiting for Zechariah and wondering why he stayed so long in the temple. When he came out, he could not speak to them. They realized he'd seen a vision in the temple, for he kept making signs to them, but remained unable to speak. When his time of service was completed, he returned home. After this, his wife Elizabeth became pregnant and for 5 months remained in seclusion. "The Lord has done this for me," she said. "In these days he has shown his favor and taken away my disgrace among the people." Praise be to God for the blessing of his holy word. Recently, I got some news. I found out that I was expecting another child. It was exciting and it was joyous, but it wasn't much of a surprise. It's the third time that I've received that news, and it wasn't completely out of the blue. I was very happy and were really excited, but it stands in contrast to the passage today and how that news was. In our passage, Zechariah, our expectant father by the end, doesn't have any children. He can't have any. He and his wife are too old, and we're told that there's other problems too. Luke tells us that she could not conceive, but as we know, back in the day, any problems with conception were rendered as she couldn't conceive. So we shouldn't read too much into that. Childlessness was a complicated matter back in first century Judea. Without the medical knowledge that we have now, there was a lot of mystery in the process. People didn't really understand why one couple would have a child and another wouldn't. We now know that these things are complicated and as much to do with chance as anything else. But back then, chance was a complicated matter. Often, chance had a lot to do with God. And children were seen, much as they are now, as a blessing. But the other side of that was the lack of them was seen as a curse. It was a sign of God's displeasure upon the family and inevitably a result of disobedience to God. This was a big issue. Elizabeth says that God has taken away her disgrace when she finally finds out she's pregnant. And I think we shouldn't underestimate how much power those words probably convey. It's really a statement of fact. As a woman who'd got older and had no children, there were probably a great many places she couldn't go. She probably wouldn't be very welcome in others. As a priest, Zechariah would be doubly troubled. He was meant to be one of God's special people. He was meant to be, in the eyes of God, a blameless person. But because he was childless, that can't have been true. Now, Luke makes sure we know right off the bat that this isn't the case, at least for these people. He tells us about how blameless they are, about how they were upright in the arms of God. There was no chance that God's displeasure was upon these two. In fact, quite the opposite. Now, those views did take a long time to go. And when they did, it was largely a result of a greater knowledge of medicine. But I think it is important that we know what was going on with the people at this time and how much of an issue this stuff was. You see, God could have chosen basically anyone to be the parents of the one that came before Jesus. But he chose to do it this way, in order to bring wholeness to these two people. Indeed, when the angel says that John will bring happiness to a lot of people, that's very, very true. And not just happiness, but social inclusion. And not just for the normal reasons that we think of today. It lifted the cultural stigma that Elizabeth and Zachariah lived under. But it also ensures their future. Without children, people would reach an old age and have no one to pay for them, no one to care for them. There was no NHS, there were no care homes, there was nothing. You were completely reliant on your children and your grandchildren. So, without them, they would have had to rely on the charity of others. Which sometimes was fine. People did feel a responsibility to provide that, but especially when times were tough, especially when things got hard, that charity wasn't always there. Or when it was, it came with other prices attached. Especially if Zachariah died before Elizabeth. That child brought wholeness and brought a future. It was a blessing to Elizabeth and Zachariah. Now, there's a lot going on in today's passage. The difficult and complicated cultural ideas around children is definitely there. But it also has details about priestly duties and administration, which I think it's worthwhile just going over. You see, priests were selected not by being the firstborn or not by being especially trained or skilled. It was genealogical. It was passed in family lines. Zachariah was a priest because his dad was. And John would be one because his dad was. And so it went on. One of the results of this was that by the time of Zachariah, there were now a lot of priests. I mean, a lot. In fact, there were too many priests. Oh, I so wish we had that problem now in Scotland, that we had too many ministers, but we don't. But what it meant was that priests were divided into 24 different orders, who served two non-consecutive weeks in the temple throughout the year. But being so many, they were again subdivided, so that on an average day there would be only a subdivision of priests actually on duty, and often a subdivision of that subdivision. And we hear that they may have split themselves further into morning, midday and evening, and then an overnight team. There really were a lot of them to go around, and their duties would have been quite light, because there were so many on duty at one time. So Zachariah is on duty that day. His division and subdivision and sub-subdivision are responsible for the temple. And they draw lots to decide who does what. Now, drawing lots was the common way of deciding these things, because it was seen as a way of taking the decision out of human hands. No one could show favouritism, no one could decide. Priests, all being equal, would simply draw lots. A lot was drawn for cleaning, a lot was drawn for handling sacrifice, for checking in at the front doors. Lots were drawn for almost everything. And one of the most important and holy duties was the daily incense offerings. They came twice a day. One right at the beginning of the day before the morning sacrifices, and one right at the end, after the last sacrifices were made. They took place up at the altar of the temple, And they were a big deal. Being selected for that was a great honour. It conveyed great holiness and allowed you to be really within God's power. And they draw lots. Now, we can infer from this a few things, one of which is that Zechariah had never done this before. Priests only got their name put in for lots if they hadn't done it before. So, which also tells you how many priests there must have been. So he does this, and he goes into that section and starts off this procedure. But standing to the right of the incense altar is an angel. We've spoken about angels over Christmas, and we don't know what this angel looked like, we don't know what it is, but we do know that it's Gabriel. Not just any angel, the archangel, God's personal messenger. So the angel says, "You're going to have a child. I know that you think that's impossible with God. Everything's possible. I want you to call him John, and he's going to be really important. He's going to bring a lot of people back to God, and he's going to make a lot of people happy." Obviously, this is fantastic news. It's amazing news. But Zechariah isn't fully convinced. He says, "How can I know that that's true? How do I know that that's going to happen?" The angel says, "Well, Zechariah, you can't possibly doubt that this message comes from God. I'm an angel, standing in one of the most holy places. In fact, I'm Gabriel. God gave me this message, God's self. God sent me to earth, just to you, to deliver it. So you know this message is from God. How can you doubt that? This is amazing news." Now, the consequence of his unbelief is that Zechariah can't speak, not until the baby's born. So he goes out of the temple, where he would normally pronounce the benediction of the day. Tell the people, that's it, we're all done, and say a blessing. But he can't, because he can't speak. Now the crowd know that he's seen something, they know that what's going on, because he's able to gesture. And he would have been in that room with two or three other priests who would have assisted him. But this is it. He can't speak. But he goes home and all this communicated to his wife, who's very pleased, and she becomes pregnant. This story is partly a precursor to another similar story that we're going to get just a few verses later. One that we covered in Advent, when Mary's told that she's going to have a child. It's also an important story because it tells us a lot about who John was. John the Baptist, the great one who came before Jesus. But it also tells us a lot about God and a lot about how we trust in God. I don't know about you, but right now, trust can be a bit hard to come by. We're told time and time again by people, "We've got this, it's okay." And it turns out they don't. We have not a lot of trust in politicians. They let us down all the time. We don't always trust newspapers, and we don't always trust the news, because it turns out some of what they say isn't true. Or it's highly slanted. Look at the problems with media in the US and what's been happening there. We definitely don't trust all that we read online. It's a huge story nowadays and causes massive problems that people trust blindly. So when we hear God telling us through his messengers, through ministers and through sermons, through the people around us, through the Bible, through direct contact with God, when God tells us we've got this, I think it's quite natural to think, really? Do we though? I'm not sure if you've ever been there. I'm not sure if you've ever been there where God tells you very clearly this is going to be okay. And it's hard to believe that. Especially now. We're in the middle of a second lockdown. It's almost as strict as the first. And if anything, it's getting stricter, not relaxing. By February, March, we were meant to be almost to the other end of this. But instead, it's getting worse still. We've got a vaccine. People are starting to get it, but it's not working the way we hoped. So right now, messages that say this is going to be okay feel a little unbelievable. So I think there's something that we can relate to when Zachariah says, but how do I know this is true? I want it to be true. I desperately want it to be true. I've been praying for it to be true, but how can I believe it? After all these years, after all these failed attempts, how do I know? We spoke last week a little bit about trust, about how we have to trust in God. And one of the places that I think trust comes from is in track record. We trust people because they are trustworthy, and they're trustworthy because what they've said turns out to be true. So the next time we trust them again. If we think about the people that we know, if we think about our friends, I'm sure you've all got this friend as well, but I have one. They come along all the time and they say, wow, you know, you'll never guess what's going to happen. You'll never guess where I'm going. Or, you know, wow, this is amazing. And it never quite turns out to actually work out. It never turns out to be that simple. They go, wow, I've heard this great gossip, you'll never guess what. No. But I'm sure you've also got a friend who is always right. Oh, I think this is how this is going to go. But they're right. I think this is who's going to win Bake Off. Yep, they'll be right. They just tend to be right. So when those two come up and tell us, this is how what I think is going to happen, who do we trust? The one who's been right so far. So when we ask ourselves, when God says things are going to be okay, we have to ask ourselves, what's God's track record been? And I think when we look, we find it's been really good. If I look back over my life, I can see the times when God's been with me. When I look at the world around me, I see a world in which God is there. When I think about the promises God has made, promises to be there, promises to answer prayer, promises of redemption, promises of forgiveness, I see them fulfilled. Time and time and time again, I see them fulfilled. In my life, in the lives of others, in the lives of my congregation, I see them fulfilled. When I see God saying, I will bring you through this, I see that he does. When I see God saying, I will never abandon you, I see no evidence of abandonment. I see God fulfill God's promises again and again. And that's why we can trust them. Because God has a good track record on this. So I don't know where everyone is today. Maybe watching this, you are a wee bit down, not seeing the end in sight, wondering what the future is going to be, and trusting is hard. Maybe you're not in that place. Maybe trusting in God is easy right now. Maybe trusting that God will bring us through is easy. Wherever you are, though, whenever we have doubt, I encourage you, look to the God you know. A God who keeps promises, a God who is faithful, a God who answers prayer, a God who's gotten you through so much before. And then ask if we can trust God. My prayer for this week, and my message for this week, is that when we hear God's promises to us, whether they are promises as personal as the one that Zechariah got, a promise of a child, whether we hear promises about God for us universally, I will bring you through, I will make you grow, I will make you prosper, or whether they are just the promises that God will never abandon us, that we put our trust in God at these times, my prayer is that you will be reassured that that trust is not misplaced. God's promises are perfect, and that God will be with us now and in eternity. Amen. Let us lift our hearts once more to God in prayer. Let us pray. Our Father, we come to you this morning praying for those in our community, those who we know and those who we don't, those who are near and those who are far off. We pray to you at a time where coronavirus is once again resurging, where things look bleak and the future uncertain. But we pray that we would have trust in you, that in you all things will one day be made right. We pray most fervently for those for whom lockdown is hardest, those kids who are missing school the most, who need it the most, those parents stuck between work and schooling and childcare and all of the other things of life that haven't stopped. We pray for those who don't have a proper home, are those for whom their home is not safe. We pray you would be with them all. Bring them hope, bring them presence, bring them your love, our God. We pray for those people who are grieving, who have lost loved ones and can't mark it in the way they would like. Those people who've lost those that they are close to through COVID or through anything else. Be with them, comfort them, show them your love as we try to be with them as a people of God. We pray for our leaders, for Boris Johnson and Nicola Sturgeon, as they make decisions that affect so many people. May they make them with the interests of all in mind, and may they be guided with you, no matter their belief. We pray as well for Joe Biden and Kamala Harris, the incoming administration in the United States. Bless them in all that they do and guide them to better leadership. Guide them to care for all, to building a nation of justice and a nation made in the image of one better. We pray as well for all those working on the front lines of our society, for teachers, for doctors, for social workers, for home carers, for police and paramedics, for all those who go to work every day, exposing themselves to risk to help others, to get others through. Bless them, our God. Bless them and be with them this day and all days as they do your work. We pray for those people at the moment who feel most We pray for those people just now who feel most outside, for refugees and asylum seekers, for people who feel themselves doubly persecuted in our society. Be with them and be with those who help them. Be also with the people at City Mission dealing with an outbreak that they're trying to contain, whilst trying to provide for those in our community with no home. Our God, there are so many people in your need. And we thank you that you care, that you are a God who does not sit passively by, but a God who intervenes. Be with us all. Be with us all as we go out into the world to fulfill your commands. Be with us all as we find ways to love you and each other more. Be with us, our God. Amen.
Sing this song of gladness, give my praise to the fountain of delights, for in my helplessness you heard my cry, and waves of mercy poured down on my life.
Well, that's been our service. I do hope it has been to you a blessing. There's a lot going on here at Neilston Parish Church. And the best way to keep up with it all is our Facebook and website. So please do check them out. Whilst we are locked down and not in the building, the work of the church goes on. So please do keep in touch with us. Let us know how you're doing and let us know if there's anything you need. We're here to serve God and serve our community. And we take that seriously. And may the one God, Father, Son, and Spirit, lift up his countenance upon you and pour out his blessings on you in this day and all days. Amen.